So in this video, I will try to explain the concept of phenomenology to the students and the novice researchers. Before talking about phenomenology, I would like to share the list of resources on phenomenological research. There are many good readings available on phenomenological research. I have included only four readings here. In fact, these are the readings which I have referred to for the preparation of this presentation. Now we will have a look at the key phenomenologists. Husserl, he is the founder of the phenomenology, and then Heidegger, he was a disciple and colleague of Husserl. Later he developed the concept of existential phenomenology. And then Levinas, Sartre, and Ponty, they are the French phenomenologists. Let's see what will be included in this video. We will see the concept of phenomenology as a philosophy. And then there will be some key terms which I will try to explain. Then phenomenology as a research design or method, then aims of phenomenology, and then key features of phenomenological research. First of all, phenomenology as a philosophy and as a research method. Phenomenology as a philosophy is about engaging in reflection on things in their appearing. We know that philosophy is a subject as well as an activity. When we say that philosophy is an activity, it means it is an activity that involves stepping back and reflecting on things. So in phenomenology too, you step back, you distance back and try to reflect on things in their appearing. On the other hand, phenomenology as a research design or method is about researching with a phenomenological lens. So many times students find it difficult to understand what is phenomenological design. They come up with questions. They are confused whether phenomenology is a philosophy, because there are good readings on phenomenology. In fact, it was a philosopher. They are many times confused. What is the difference between phenomenology as a philosophy and phenomenology as a research design? So, in simple words, phenomenology as a philosophy is about thinking about appearances of the things, whereas phenomenology as a research design is about investigating something, doing some empirical activity, using scientific method to investigate something, but your lens is phenomenological lens. So let's see phenomenology as a philosophy. In the previous slide, we tried to compare phenomenology as a philosophy and as a research method in a very, very simple way, in simple words. It's not that simple, but I try to simplify things. So phenomenology is about gaining a deeper understanding of the nature or meaning of our everyday experiences. The philosophers which apply phenomenology, they try to gain a deeper understanding of the nature or meaning of our everyday experiences. We experience so many things in life. A phenomenologist is interested in understanding the meaning of those experiences. Phenomenology asks, what is this or that kind of experience like? Experience of motherhood, experience of freedom, experience of liberation, experience of doing something. So there are different experiences. We experience so many things in our daily lives, and phenomenology is about what is this or that. A number of qualitative approaches to research have borrowed and built upon phenomenological philosophy. So phenomenology is a philosophy, is considered a philosophy. It is a philosophy, and there are number of qualitative approaches which have borrowed and built upon the concept of phenomenological philosophy. For example, hermeneutics and phenomenography, they are different kinds of researches which are based on the philosophy of phenomenology. There are phenomenology asks for a transcendental phenomenological attitude. To be a phenomenologist, one has to adopt transcendental perspective or transcendental attitude. What does it mean? Transcendental phenomenological attitude means an attitude of consciousness that transcends or surpasses or goes beyond the orientation toward the human mode of being conscious. It is free from worldly and empirical assumptions. When we say that it is free from worldly and empirical assumptions, means a phenomenologist does not make any assumptions either empirically or already established or worldly. To be in the phenomenological attitude means two things: performing the epoche or bracketing and the reduction. So these are the two key processes which are involved in phenomenology, and they are expected. And transcendental phenomenological attitude, in fact, it involves bracketing as well as reduction. So what are they? Let's have a look at them. Bracketing, setting aside. To bracket means to put aside all knowledge of the phenomenon being explored or investigated that is not due to actual instance of this phenomenon. Thus, all past knowledge derived from readings or other secondary sources, as well as one's former personal experiences with the phenomenon, are meant to be excluded. That we bracket all that knowledge. For example, if a researcher is a female and she is trying to understand the leadership experiences of female leaders, then being a female, she has, and like particularly if she is in a leadership position, then she has many perceptions, she has her personal experiences, and she definitely had read a lot of theory as well. So when she is going to do a phenomenological study, she is interested in investigating the experiences of the female leaders, then she needs to put aside all that knowledge, all those perceptions aside, and she should be approaching the phenomenon without this baggage. She should put these things aside. So it is not about disbelieving the knowledge and theory. It is about putting that aside when taking on the role of a phenomenologist, or it is about bracketing that or setting aside. So the next as important feature of a transcendental phenomenological attitude is reduction. This is an other element of that attitude. So the reduction refers to the fact that one has to refrain from positing, theorizing the existence of the given. This means that a phenomenologist is not interested in interpreting or theorizing of the existence. It is about searching or assigning meanings to the given that is appearing. Phenomenologists are not concerned about the existence or reality of the given. One considers the given, even if it is real, as something present to one's consciousness without affirming that it exists in the way that it presents itself. So a phenomenologist considers the given, whether that is real or that is a perception, The phenomenologist will take that as a perception or something that is in the person's in their consciousness without affirming that it exists in the way that it presents itself. It is taken to be something present to one's consciousness, a phenomenon, not a reality. A phenomenologist is not interested in knowing about the existence or reality, or does not comment on the reality or existence. Rather, a phenomenologist comments on the phenomenon. The phenomenologist takes that as a perception or something that is present to one's consciousness. So in other words, it is a reduction from existence to presence. So when we say that a transcendental phenomenological attitude is, when we talk about transcendental phenomenological attitude, it means that a person applies reduction as well as bracketing. When we say bracketing, means the person puts aside all her or his knowledge and assumptions. And the second is that reduces the existence of something to presence. So a phenomenologist is interested in the presence, not in the existence of anything. So, or it is setting aside judgments about the realness of the phenomenon. The phenomenology is not interested in the realness of the phenomenon, just in the phenomenon, in the present of the phenomenon. So let's see what phenomenological research is about. Phenomenological research is the study of lived experience, or the study of the live world, the world as we immediately experience it pre-reflectively, rather than as we conceptualize, categorize, or reflect on it. So phenomenological research is study of the lived experience without reflecting on that, just studying the lived experience. So that is the key point of phenomenological research. It is not about the conceptualization of the experience or categorization of the experience, rather in its very pure form. So lived experience means the very pure form of the experience. What counts as phenomenology? There are many research papers which use the word phenomenology, and the authors claim that they conducted phenomenological research. So here the important question is that what counts as phenomenology? A research is phenomenological research if it is rigorously descriptive. That is the important point of research, that of phenomenological research. The phenomenological research is very much descriptive. It uses phenomenological reductions. We have spoken about phenomenological reductions, and discloses the essence or structures of meaning intrinsic in human experiences through the use of imaginative variation. So a research can be considered a phenomenological research if it is descriptive, it involves reductions, and it discloses the essence or structure of meanings intrinsic in human experiences, which are not visible, rather they are intrinsic, they are hidden in human experiences through the use of imaginative variation. So the researcher does imaginative variation to disclose those essences or structures of meanings. So again, I'm going to revisit the concept of bracketing, because in this slide we have seen that it is about phenomenological reductions. Phenomenological reductions are not possible without bracketing. Bracketing and reductions, they go side by side. So bracketing means to put aside all knowledge of the phenomenon being explored or investigated that is not due to the actual instance of this phenomenon. Thus, all past knowledge derived from readings or other secondary sources, as well as one's former personal experiences with the phenomena, are meant to be excluded. Novice researchers often misunderstand this process of bracketing as an initial first step, where subjective bias is acknowledged as part of the project to establish the rigor and validity of the research. Many times, the researchers mention it in detail that they have applied a phenomenological approach, and then they explain what are their personal biases, and then they try to establish the rigor and validity of the research by highlighting these things and by mentioning. They are very reflexive, and they mention what are their subjective biases. In fact, bracketing involves a process whereby one simply refrains from positing altogether. Means a phenomenological researcher is expected to bracket all these things. The person is not needed to mention these things in her or his study, because it is expected that the researcher would bracket her or his prior assumptions and subjective experiences. Instead, in hermeneutics, yes, the researchers present their subjective biases and they acknowledge them, but in pure phenomenological research, the researcher is expected to bracket these things. In phenomenological studies, three particular areas of presupposition need to be set aside. They are scientific theories, knowledge and explanation, truth or falsity of claims being made by the participant, because we are not interested in knowing the existence. We are interested in knowing the present or appearance or phenomenon. Personal views and experiences of the researcher, which would cloud his descriptions of the phenomenon itself. Importantly, this setting aside is carried out throughout the research process and is not just a first step. So phenomenological researchers should be very careful when they are studying experiences, because their research will not be counted as phenomenological research if they are not bracketing and doing reduction. Now, I would like to share with you what is phenomenological research not about. We know that phenomenological research is about studying persons. It is about studying lived experiences. Let's see what is it not about. Phenomenology does not describe actual states of affairs. For example, if we take time, maybe I'm talking to you for 5 minutes, so you will say that the 5 minutes have passed and you are watching this video. That is the actual state of affairs, 5 minutes, but your experience of watching the video, if I explore those experiences, then that will be something related to phenomenology. So actual states do not matter in phenomenology. Rather, it is about how people live those states. It is not about answering who did what or when or where, how many did something, to what extent something was done, under what conditions. So phenomenologists do not answer such kind of questions. It is important as well to realize that phenomenology cannot be used to show or prove, for example, that one reading method is more effective than another reading method, or that certain instructional techniques produce higher achievement scores and so forth. So phenomenologists or phenomenological researchers do not try to prove something. So they are not like quantitative research methods. Phenomenology does not allow for empirical generalizations, the production of law-like statements, or the establishment of functional relationships. So there is many times I've seen that people have confusion regarding phenomenology and case study, because there are some papers which mention phenomenology as well as case study. So especially novice researchers, they become very confused that how can a study be case study or phenomenology is a subcategory of case study research, or case study research is a kind of phenomenological research. So these are the confusions which are there among the students and novice researchers. So here I'm going to try to address that confusion. So case studies focus on a certain situation, event, activity, a group or institutional location to study it for what goes on there, how these individuals or members of this group perceive things, and how they might differ in time and place from other such groups or situations. So they are interested in studying what is going on there, about activity or event or situation. There may be a phenomenological quality to case studies in that they ask people to talk about their experiences. That could be there. That is one aspect of a case study. They can have a flavor of phenomenology, but the end of case study is to describe accurately an existing state of affairs. I go back to the previous slide. This slide. Here you can see that phenomenology does not describe actual states of affairs. Case study is interested in reaching to a conclusion that is about actual states of affairs. So it is case studies, at the end of case studies is to describe accurately an existing state of affairs. Phenomenology does not aim at that. And this state of affairs might change quite drastically over time and from place to place. Thus, it would be inaccurate to speak of the phenomenology of BNU, Beacon Hills National University, or phenomenology of an XYZ university. We can carry out case study of the institutions, but we cannot do phenomenology of the institutions, because case study involves cases. Case study means study of cases, and case can be of any form. But phenomenology is the study of persons, their lived experiences. And moreover, case study is time bound, maybe something which happened from 2011 to 2012, and an institution was studied for that period of time. Certainly that will not be the case if this same institution is studied in 2019 or 2020. So case study is time bound, and the purpose of case study is to reach to some accurate existing state of affairs. Phenomenology is not about that. Any research which does not have at its core the description of the things in their appearing. So appearing is important, not the existence. Phenomenological researchers do not try to reach to the existence or talk about the existence. Rather, they are interested in the phenomenon, the way people are taking that or experiencing that. So the a research which does not have its core the description of the things in their appearing, focusing on experience as lived, cannot be considered phenomenological. So what are the aims of the phenomenological research? From a phenomenological point of view, to do research is to know the world in which we live as human beings, and since to know the world is profoundly to be in the world. You cannot know something unless you are there in that thing. For example, you cannot know swimming in its true sense. You might get information about swimming, but you will know swimming only once you are there in water, and you are there and in that world, then you will know that. Similarly, you cannot know driving unless you drive. So to know the world is profoundly to be in the world in a certain way. The act of researching is the intentional act of attaching ourselves to the world. So phenomenological researchers, they claim that they intentionally attach themselves to the world. They intentionally attach themselves to the world to become more fully part of it. When a phenomenological researcher explores or investigates experiences of a certain group of people, the person, the phenomenological researcher, attaches herself or himself to that, to the world, to that particular experience. So phenomenology calls this inseparable connection to the world the principle of intentionality. So principle of intentionality means that a researcher acts purposefully with an intention to connect to the world, to become part of the world. The researcher is interested in understanding those phenomena. So the researcher becomes part of the world. So let's have a look at some features of phenomenological research. Phenomenological research methods are responsive to both the phenomenon and the subjective interconnection between the researcher and the researched. So when we talk about subjective interconnection between the researcher and the researched, means that researcher is bracketing and applying reduction. The researcher has transcendental phenomenological attitude. Phenomenology is the systematic attempt to uncover and describe the structures, the internal meaning structures of lived experiences. A universal or essence may only be intuited or grasped through a study of the particulars or instances as they are encountered in lived experience. So the phenomenological researchers, they try to capture the essence of an experience. And when they are trying to capture the essence of experience, it means they are trying to, they will try to take experience as something universal. And to reach to that universal, they would try to look at the particular instances as they are encountered in lived experiences of the individuals. For example, phenomenology does not ask how do these children learn this particular material, but it asks what is the nature or essence of the experience of learning, so that I can now better understand what this particular learning experience is like for these children. So let's see a few points related to sampling and data in phenomenology. Phenomenological studies apply purposive sampling, and there are usually 3 to 4 or 6 participants, usually 3 to 10 participants. Mostly data is gathered through in-depth interviews. Phenomenological research uses the analysis of significant statements, the generation of meaning units, and the development of essence description. So means that the phenomenological researchers, they analyze significant statements provided by the participants, and then they generate meaning units, and then and the development of essence description. Then they present a description that may be labeled as essence, that description has captured the essence of the experience, lived experience. So data interpretation, there are different methods of interpreting the data or focusing the data interpretation. So in one method, the ideographic analysis may form part of the process of analysis, but the eventual aim is to explicate or clarify the phenomenon as a whole, regardless of the individual's concern. So in Husserl's description of phenomenology, and then Gaorgi's method is very much rooted in Husserl's description of phenomenology. He thinks that the purpose of phenomenological research is to understand the phenomenon as a whole, to capture the essence of the phenomenon or the lived experience as a whole. And individuals do not matter in that. On the other side, there are some phenomenologists who explicitly seek out ideographic meanings in an attempt to understand the individual, which may or may not offer general insights. So the other phenomenologists, they are interested in the experiences of the individuals. They are not interested in the whole, in the essence. Rather, they are interested in capturing the essence of the experience in individual terms. So they are interested. They analyze data to reach to some conclusions which are more individual oriented. There are other phenomenologists which combine both. They take care of individual experiences as well as they talk about the essence of the lived experience as a whole too. So there are certain variations of data interpretation in phenomenology. There are some variations of phenomenology in this video. I'm not going to talk about them. Hermeneutics, interpretive phenomenological analysis, and phenomenography. But I would like to talk about descriptive versus interpretive or hermeneutic phenomenology. Strict followers of Husserl's transcendental method would insist that phenomenological research is pure description and that interpretation or hermeneutics falls outside the bounds of phenomenological research. However, there are other phenomenologists who believe in hermeneutics, and they think that hermeneutics is a kind of phenomenology. So phenomenology is a research design and it is a philosophy. Husserl and Heidegger are the key figures in phenomenology, in the philosophy of phenomenology. And there are French phenomenologists as well, Levinas and Poynting and Sartre. Their work is more related to existential phenomenology.